somebody saying something they would like be interested in talking about today. Let's just have that. That's a good start. John, you came the farthest distance. You want to lay out one you would like to have talked about?
How about taking charge of our inner feelings?
That sounds pretty good. That's the first start in it. Take charge. My inner state of being, okay? Now, as long as we got John to start, somebody else give me one, okay? I like to have your choices. Yeah, how about you, Kevin? I'm about to have something you want to talk about. What did you want to transform?
Get loaded.
Oh,
huh? You're embarrassed at the moment.
Working with energy levels.
Working with energy levels. That's a good one. Due to changing environments all the time and changing things around it. In other words, if you're cold, you feel shivery and you want to do something, you jump around to get warm, put on more clothes, turn on the heat, what have you. So we're trying to work with the physical body, so that determines one of it. Now, we happen to have decided certain things in our life, and as well to look at what we decided and see if we still agree that they're correct. Now, most of these things we decided come up as a firm conclusion was made when we were tiny little children, more than likely from the first day we were born on. You know, we didn't have words then, but we sure had feelings. You've listened to babies, everybody here has a constrained by a lot of things, don't they? And they'll curry every once in a while. The right to, they do that. So we will first start out with the fundamental conclusion. Now we have the statement that we kick around. Now just the statement wouldn't do you any good, but I'll kick it out anyway. When once a decision has been made with feeling, it's the rule of attitude action from now on until we totally reevaluate that decision. Okay? Now that's one of those things you don't need to make a note of, but remember that whenever we firmly come up with something, it's still there. Even though it was made without words, so obviously we only recall in words since we've grown up because we got accustomed to them and so forth. But we'll go back to the feeling, because that's the one John asked us to talk about, the inner state of being. So the first thing we decided on being born, we had been living in our existing, call it whichever one you like. Come right in, sir. We were waiting for you. First thing we decided after having survived for a while in this lovely, non-disturbed state in the uterine world, you know, nothing bothers you much, the temperature's about constant, nobody's hollering at you, nobody's saying don't do that, nobody's saying hurry up, nobody's saying eat your dinner or anything else, you just light it up, kicking, moving around, mostly sucking their thumb and having a pretty good time. If you don't think they suck their thumb, you get a picture of one in utero and you'll find that's usually what they're doing. They got a thumb stuck in their mouth. And doing pretty good. Nothing's bothering. Everything's fine. Nothing to complain about. So, as soon as you're born, man, you begin to get a gob of disturbances. First place, it's very disturbing to be born. Mama fusses, but you should feel what the kid feels. That's more something. And as soon as he gets born, somebody starts poking him around, and they're chilly, and they're a whole bunch of other things, and very uncomfortable. So, of course, the obvious decision is that the whole purpose of this living bit out here that we got thrown into all of a sudden is to regain the non-disturbed state. Now, that is not the way planet Earth works, you know, while we're here. I think all of us have noticed that, have you not? That you get disturbed every now and then from something comes along. It's noisy, or it's cold, hot, or something is uncomfortable from your physical senses, and you don't like that very well. I don't care what it is, you don't like it. Some people like noise, other people like quiet and peace. Some people in quiet and peaceful situations are extremely bored. Have you ever noticed that? Bored to death. Gotta get where the action is. So here comes this whole bit of that we have a fundamental purpose. Now, let's check it out for a few minutes and see if about everything we do is not to regain the non-disturbed state. Is that about right, John?
Yes, sir.
You got a pain somewhere, you immediately want it fixed. Is that right? You may go through a hell of a lot of pain to get it fixed, but you go at it trying to get it fixed. Is that right? So, if we are bored, we want to have company. If we have company, we'd like for them to go every once in a while. And, you know, one said, the most interesting about your presence is the absence of it. So, this goes on and on. So we are busy if we look. We go to work, make a lot of money because we think it'll buy non-disturbance. Find out that the only thing that really buys is taxes. But and we go on with this year in, year out. So now most of your life, John, been spent trying to be non-disturbed. Is that about right?
That's right.
Now, I think everybody else could answer that all right, but Carolyn and Harry and Perry, this situation anymore. By asking everybody, is that about correct, that everything you do is to try to be non-disturbed? Everything we possibly can. Now, I think we could all take some time and reevaluate that decision. We live on planet Earth, which has an ever-changing thing going on and was not described as heaven to anybody. And I doubt if heaven is totally non-disturbed. If I went there looking to be, something would go haywire. Those hearts would get on my nerves after a while. Other things. I was in the dining room night before last down in San Jose, and a lady come out with her big heart. I just said she'd stop. She didn't really turn me on, you know, the way she was doing things. So we could say, now I'm going to live on planet Earth, and I'm not in a hurry to leave. Anybody here in a hurry to get out? I like it here. It's noisy at times. It's cold at times. Hot at times. All sorts of wonderful things, murders, suicides, everything goes on. But I'm not in a hurry to leave yet. Anybody here in a hurry to get out? Well, we can make arrangements to open the window. And take care of that in a matter of seconds. So, we want to be here, so let's be a little realistic. If you're going to be disturbed sometimes, John, there's going to be things you don't like. Now, that don't mean you have to be disturbed just because something's going on you don't like. Is that all right? I experience many things today that I don't like. So what? I'm free to experience whatever's going on. That's what this system is about. If I had something happen to my central nervous system, I could no longer feel anything. That'd be pretty bad. We got, I don't want a finger from something years ago. I just do need to come to and start half feeling it. You know, and do all sorts of things. It's handy when I'm cooking. You can stick it in the plate and see if it feels my right inside. Pull it out. Don't hurt it. Sometimes it makes it. So, obviously, we would like to have sensation. Is that right? We're worried about it. You wake up with something numb someday and it stays numb more than a few minutes, you get concerned. Is that correct? I want it to all work. So, now, when you reevaluate this decision from the years of we've been around experience, we would very much like to have sensation. That's it. We don't have it. Correct? Bad way. So the whole purpose of living is not to regain a non-disturbed state. Now, if we get that one point down, we then find, well, I'm perfectly free to experience whatever arises today. I'm going to experience it anyway. I might as well do it gracefully. Is that right? If somebody grumps at you, you're going to experience it, aren't you? The other day I was driving down the street and a bicycle rider was behind me and I had to put over the brake because they would, I didn't have to, I could run over the dog ran out in front of me. I stepped on a brake. He wobbled real hard to get his bike stopped. He's one of these racers, you know, with a helmet, tight zip pants and shirt, everything. He was picked out for professional bicycle riding. And he became disturbed. So he comes up by the window and calls me a few dirty names and slams the side of the car. Well, obviously he hurt his hand where he hit the car. But he didn't hurt the car at all. But he made a lot of noise and I guess he felt better then because he had stuck up for his rights or something. So what? Now I'm perfectly free to experience bicycle riders on the street. They're all right. They're doing what they feel is right, proper, and justifiable. So why should I get upset because this guy is, okay? Now, I could have jumped out of the car and made all sorts of commotions and threatened him. We've had a battle rock, but he's a lot younger than I am, so I wouldn't go out there and fight him. I take him besides that, I don't have a nice suit. I don't like those messed up. Mama told me early, you're fighting hard on your clothes, so don't do it. So we'll not play with that. But But here you could take one thing and say that trying to spend my life trying to be non-disturbed is a big waste. Is that right? That's a big waste. So I'm not going to try to do it. Now there's four ways, basically, that we can be disturbed. And so the little fella started out first and wanted to get pleasure and comfort. Pleasure and comfort. Boy, that's nice stuff, you know. And it wanted to escape all pain. Now, we always think of pain as something bad, and we should take a pill for it, or get an operation for it, or whatever the case may be. But wouldn't we be in a very precarious, dangerous situation if I could not feel sensations that I don't like, which we all call pain? Is that right? I could take a hold of a hot skillet handle and never notice a thing. Everything's going fine till I smell of burning flesh. And then I might notice something gone haywire, but even I don't like the smell of burning flesh, so that is pain too. So I just would be violated very shortly if I could not feel pain. Is that right? You couldn't make them, could you, John? Huh? That's the only way it tells you stop it. Sometimes, is that right? So, pleasure and comfort, wonderful stuff. I just love it. But I know I'm not going to have it all the time. Are you? I can't do that. I have my supply of it about every day. But I don't expect to have it last all day long, every day. Sometimes it does. So what? I'm just thankful and go on. And knowing this, sooner or later, the pain will come. Now, another thing we all want is attention. Now, the baby's going to get attention because it starts crying. And that's the most unpleasant sound on planet Earth. So then we do something about it right quick. So it learns this magic formula. All you got to do is complain and I'll be fixed. Things will be fixed up. Or everybody will be working at it anyway. We'll all be trying. And we want to escape being ignored. Now every once in a while, driving on a highway, I drive like 75 or 80 miles an hour, and I sure hope that guy with the little lights on top of his car ignores me. I don't like to pay the penalty for that one, but I do like to wheel on down the road every once in a while. You do that, John? You increase the speed limit down then?
Occasionally.
And don't you hope you're ignored?
Yes, sir.
I do. So, again, we have certain times I like to be ignored, and then certain times I like to have attention, but I always know how to get it. All I got to go out and dish out some of it, and I'll get attention. I go give other people, I know they're all hungry for attention, so I'll give them some. You know what? They always give me some back. Maybe not as much as I've asked out, but I get enough. And the day I know I don't miss. I need a little bit, but not a whole lot. I found out what effort I'm willing to put out to get how much I need for today. That's simple reason. Now, we all need some approval. And we all want to escape disapproval. Now, I've noticed in my years of being around a lot of people is that there's one person you disapprove of more than anybody else. Just one. You know who that is? Number one. You go around picking on yourself. Now, I'm not going to disapprove of you, but you sure could, huh? That's where we get all these funny little feelings like embarrassment and everything. We're disapproving of ourselves to start with. Well, if I approved of you, I'm not going to be embarrassed or bashful or any of these things. I just want to do it. But if I start picking on me and say, well, I don't look right, I don't sound like, I may make an ass out of myself, et cetera, et cetera. So we start off that the major person we disapprove of is the one you're going to spend your life with. Not just part of it, but all of it. You can't get a divorce. You're stuck. You're going to be with you, so he might as well like you. I think you're wonderful. I don't see why you can't. Okay? I know people who wouldn't, by any stretch of their imagination, ever put anybody down except themselves, but they do an awful good job of that a lot of the time. You put yourself down, Carolyn? Huh? You? Yeah.
For sure.
What do you got against you? You look like a nice person to me. I would enjoy your company. Aren't you quite delightful? Why would you go around putting yourself down? Nobody told you it was a thing to do. So now you go around disapproving of at least one person. Is that right, John? You may not disapprove of anybody else in the world, but who is the one you disapprove?
John.
You are for John all the time. Is that right? And of course, we want to feel useful until somebody starts using us. This sounds good to say, I want to be useful. Okay? I want to do something worthwhile in the world. I don't know what it is. I tell people that the nicest thing you can do is contribute to a pleasant, harmonious feeling wherever you are. Can't you do that? I do that driving in the car by myself. Is that right? Sweet little old lady came in the office the other day. She's lost her eyesight. She is more than legally blind. She can make out light with one eye with a jewelry group on. And she's in the age which most people retire. I don't like that word. Terrible. But anyway, she's retired. That means tired and then more tired again. She's retired. And she wanted to do volunteer work. Everything she called up, she wanted to volunteer, and they said, well, can you type, can you stuff in ballots, can you put stamps on this, and, you know, the usual work, you can't get anybody paid to do it, so don't somebody do it for nothing. And of course, she said, no, I can't do it. I said, well, here's the name of a man who's the head of a big nonprofit group very near where you live. And they have all kinds of folks running through their place, which they are too good or money. And I said, you call him up and tell him that you have a specialty of providing a pleasant, harmonious mood wherever you go and that you would like to volunteer your services. Well, she thought that was all right. She said, well, what if he don't take me? I said, well, I'll make the phone call. I called him. Hey, Ron, got a lady. She's a specialty in providing pleasant, harmonious moods. You got room for it? He said, God, yes. You got three more? So, you know, she's a volunteer immediately now. But you know something. So, we also all want to escape the feeling of inferiority. That's why we go around picking on ourselves. We feel inferior. Now, there's no two of us alike. Now, if you had two of these flowers here, I'm real alike. This one and that one over there, they're different, aren't they? Now, which one's the better and which one's the worst and so forth? They're both beautiful, aren't they? They're unique works of life, unique work of art. So how are you inferior? I came up here on an airplane. I can't fly that big jet, but the guy up there in front could, and I sure thankfully he could, so I can take him out. Not inferior to him. I can do a bunch of things he can't do. I can do a bunch of them he can't do. Is there something you can do pretty well? One or two, anything, huh? Nothing else. Sit around, look pretty, improve the scenery. You can always do that, but just sitting still, right? You can improve the scenery. So then you're not inferior to anybody in the world. You're a unique work of art. Life painted a beautiful picture and did a thing, and here I am. So, somebody don't like me, they just have poor taste. I'm not going to bother with people with poor taste, are you? So you're not inferior. So with having all of these, we reverted back, so we're always feeling on this side. I'm having pain, so something terrible is wrong with me, and you think you got troubles and you got a pain, but wait till you go to the doctor and get a diagnosis. Now you've got a problem. You've really got something. That's the most dangerous thing to your health there is. You know, saying that I could use the bottles of wine, all have signs on them that says this product may be hazardous to your health, but it's not on the physician's front door. But that's the biggest hazard you ever have, is to get a diagnosis. That's really dangerous. You get diagnosed with having cancer, they might as well shoot you. And down where I live, there's a considerable number of people been diagnosed with having AIDS, acquired immune deficiency. You might as well shoot them. Get it over with right now. Because they're going to have nothing but misery from now on, and there isn't anything wrong with them. They could just as easily have acquired super immunity and get this along. You can acquire either one, what you do. You can acquire either one. No problem. You can get it anywhere. So, the first thing we did was go back like the child for the first 2 years of your life. When you complain, everybody jumped to try to get you comfortable to shut that crying up, because they wanted to be comfortable, okay? And you're not comfortable with a baby crying. So, complaining began to be a way of life. Now, you didn't notice that after a couple of years, it quit working very well. You ever notice your complaining don't get you anything? Huh? Have you ever noticed that? It's more of the same stuff than somebody else. And then, of course, we got a little older, we started stomping our little feet, holding our breath, and a whole bunch of other things. Sticking up for our rights. Now, I recall how I got here. I happen to remember that. I broke, helpless, naked, unable to speak a language, unable to do anything for myself back then. Maybe gain nourishment a little bit was about the only thing. And you couldn't do anything. Now, what kind of rights have you got when you arrived here and found a well-equipped world? It was equipped, but there was a couple of slaves to look after you. And you had food, clothing, shelter, and transportation. You had that ever since you got here, right? Mm-hmm. You didn't bring it with you, did you? And you had all these people taking care of you, and they had highways and roadways and airplanes and trains and automobiles when you got here. They have cars. They didn't have cars when I got here, but they got them pretty quick for me. So, I've been kind of fascinated with them ever since. Didn't have any around. We had horses hitched to a little weak wagon when I got here. But nevertheless, all these things are here. I got a long time with the horses. So, we didn't do a thing to have all these beautiful highways, hotels built, and take off across the country. No matter where to stop, there's a hotel, and there's a restaurant. If I forget to take something with me, there's a store that's got to run down the street, right? I travel light, because I always maintain with a guy that ran down the way. That's the way I used to get new clothes. I travel overseas to meet some more, so go buy it then. Brought it with you, wouldn't do that. So we have everything provided for us, but we didn't do anything to get it very much. Is that right? It was already here. They were bringing oranges from the south, and Japan, and wherever. Everything was all here. So we don't have any rights. I have a tremendous lot of privileges. But the only time that I lose a privilege is when I mistake it for a right and start sticking up for it. Man, do they go quick. You ever notice that? Huh? I don't have any rights anywhere, but I have a lot of privileges. My system is that I have a privilege. The best way to keep it is to appreciate it by my behavior, see that it's a privilege, and then I'm going to enhance it if possible by doing a pretty nice thing. And I'm going to try to get some more, because I just love privileges, but I don't have any rights. Do you have any rights? I can't see it one minute. So if we get that out of your head, Don, you think you have any rights?
No, sir.
Have you generally acted as though you did through the years?
Yes.
Yep. Okay, now we're trying to produce, Don, an immediate transformation. So when I see certain things, I'm a transformed being. So, I stick up for rights. Now on the other side of the coin, folks got tired of all our complaining and so forth when I was about 2 years old and began trying to housebreak us a little bit. I guess that's the word, isn't it? They trained us in the way we should go. So their way, they figured we should go is please everybody. So we started trying to please because it was painful not to. Please everybody all the time. Now that brought about a split because I'm here complaining, sticking up for rights to get all my way to be non-disturbed, and here's somebody trying to tell me I gotta do something else. So that brings a split. Now you've got a split up person apart. You're in conflict. You know about conflict? You know about conflict? You know about conflict? Okay, we all know about conflict. Now, I want to stick up for my rights and complain, but if I do, that'll cause pain, so I'll try to please everybody. But I don't want to please those people. I want me pleased. Is that right? But I must do it now. Right? So now I've got conflict. A new thing has come into existence called conflict. Inner conflict, John. Before I was only in conflict with the environment. Mama may not do what I wanted to, so I screamed louder and kicked the floor and a few other things. So I may be in conflict outside, but never inner conflict until this happening came along. Now this is your inner state of being then. It's basically conflict. Well, that brought about the necessity to have a chooser up here. The chooser called itself I, and it tried to choose between these two ways of doing things. Please them or complain and stick up for my rights, okay? Now, as we did that, the chooser has a very unpleasant task, John. If he gives this one the nod, this makes him feel guilty. Now we got a new one coming in, guilt. You ever feel guilty about anything?
Yes.
Now there's feeling in it. Huh? Isn't that terrible? And then, if we give this side the nod over here, we felt guilty. If we give this one the nod, then we weren't getting to do what I wanted to do, so we felt self-pity. And that is even more painful. That's got the whole thing screwed up. Now this goes along as somewhere, of course you can put all kinds of synonyms on this. You wouldn't say you have self-pity. Other people have it. But you're depressed. Same word. Same situation, but a different word. One is a diagnostic term, and the other one is just plain people shouldn't do that. You shouldn't feel sorry for yourself. I can't. Because I'm entitled to it the way I've been treated, but nobody else should have it. But now if you go to the physician and tell you how you feel, he'll tell you you're depressed and give you some Elevil or something like that. You know, pep you up a little bit. Or you can go out here on the street and get you several things that will ease the situation for a little bit. Then you have to get in trouble, keep that up all the time. Then we were told that you, when it was trying to raise us up the way we go, they took us to various and sundry so-called authorities. They showed us the policeman that would cause us trouble if we didn't be as good kids, and the sheriff and so on, and they showed us these various and sundry other things. They took us to church on Sunday morning maybe and told us how good we had to be here. We went and left being scorched. And you know, that's pretty much seen it to be that way from now on. It's bad enough to get burned for a minute, but think forever. So, believe and do as you're told by your authorities. Now, our authorities get more and more as we grow. Believe and do as told by your authorities. Now, obviously, the authority is going to tell me something that will be to his advantage, not mine. Doesn't make sense, no? All they're trying to do is not to make us conscious or live well, but to make us be good, as they call it, which don't make no waves, don't rattle no doors, don't rock any boats. Just be a good, get a job, vote money, pay your taxes, vote when they tell you to, regardless of what you got to vote for. And then when you get all through, they'll have probate. Okay, make sure you do all those other things first. Now this is, then we get into the idea with ourselves, maybe that I should improve myself. Oh man, did you ever try to do that? What would you do, put another head on, or another arm, or another two stomachs or something like that, huh? I don't know how to improve. I've looked at human beings inside and out. I've taken them apart down to the tiniest pieces. I could even remotely decide to improve as quickly as work for real. Can you think of any way to improve a human being? Any of them? I don't know. Would you? Would you like to have another arm or something? Huh? You couldn't think of one?
Coming to this class?
Well, this is not improving you. It's trying to take you apart. It's really throwing off the junk, you know. See, it's like you found a great treasure out in the field somewhere buried. That's a little metal detector went out there and found something. Now, all you got to do to get the treasure is take the dirt off. You don't have to change the treasure in any way, do you? Just get the dirt off of it. So we just talked about some dirt we all been going around. Every morning we get up, we put a 150-pound sack over your shoulder and start off with it like we got to carry it. And we don't ever set it down. You don't want to go to bed. Don't set it down beside the bed lid on the chest. Just old concrete box and roll bricks. So we can do that. Then we finally decided really how it was. And that didn't work very well. We decided if you and she and he and they and it were all different, then I would be fine. Try that one out. That'll mow you up tight. He or she or they or it and everything else was all different, then I would be okay. All right. So now we learn how to blame. Now, here goes. These three are tormentors. These three are tempters. These over here are the great reprovers. They reprove you all the time. Both of them are tormentors. Now we set ourselves up in the middle of constant torment. Anytime we're not totally distracted, we're tormented. Is that right, John? Yes. We'll hunt for a lot of distractions. You know, if you furnish distraction, you want to make a lot of money, get in the distraction business. Is that correct?
Yes.
Do baseball players get more money than most businessmen? And the boxers get more, and the hockey players get more, and football players, and so forth, all out there. Do the entertainers on the stage, comedians make more money than hardworking people? Because we like to be distracted, because the only peace we can have is when we are distracted. Is there a radio in your car? Hey, got a telephone too, Jeff?
Yes.
Okay. I got a telephone, but I'll take it in the car. And I go out the door, it's locked. I'm going to leave that telephone there. I don't want that thing with me. But we spend a lot of our funds for being distracted. Is that correct? Shows, we go to entertainment places, which there's nothing wrong with it, but those people are paid more. Think of Michael Jackson. He makes more money than we'll ever hear about in our life, let's see, or get a hold of. Does he do anything very worthwhile, or is he just distracting people?
Distracting.
Okay. Now, can you reevaluate this whole situation here right now, Don? That you don't need to be is the purpose of living. Your whole purpose is to be non-disturbed. Is that, can you see that's kind of a big joke? Huh? It's a big joke I played on. Sure, we played it on ourselves. Doesn't matter. We're not picking on anybody or anything. Anyway, we did it as a kid with what light we had as a child. It seemed the thing to do. But I've got more light today. I don't have to do that. Do you? Can you totally reevaluate that and kick it out right now?
I don't see why you couldn't.
Now that's a philosophical answer. We can philosophize here until hell freezes over. But let's come back. Can you do it?
Yes.
Right now?
Yes.
Okay, then that's what you came here for. The thing on it said it was a talk on personal integration or being transformation. Do are a transformed individual when your purpose of living is no longer just to be non-disturbed. Okay? Then you can go out and live freely and with everything there. So you do this all at once, or you can take 20 years. I know people have taken several lifetimes and they're still fighting with it. Okay? But you can do it right now. Now, of course, that once somebody says, well, I couldn't do that, or it won't work. See, we can sit here and talk for umpteen years. I think we can keep the same subject going on transformation for weeks and months and years. I've been talking on it for 40-some-odd years. I've run out yet, so I can keep on. That's all right. Okay? But unless you apply it, it's just so much stuff. Might even serve as a distraction sometimes, just for a little while. So I usually try to see if we have a little bit of time while we do all these things. Might as well have a little distraction. But you can do that, can you not, John? Right here, right now. Your purpose of living is living. Living includes experiencing freely everything that comes your way today. It includes deciding what you want to do. Take off and go do it. You know, it may not work. Everything's an experiment. And have you run experiments that didn't work? What you do with it? You flush it. And if you got some to work, you use them. Is that right? You say, well, that wouldn't work. Now, here, we have not thought of this as an experiment, but we've been experimenting with using infantile methods and principles to try to live in a grown-up world. Is that right? Now, you've had a good long time to run the experiment. Huh? Yeah. It hasn't ever worked yet. I guess it's time to flush it. Okay, now let's try one of saying I'm free to experience whatever may come along today. Okay? Now, I'm going to draw an analogy. You know, we generally learn by analogies far more than we do straight things. So I'm going to put up an analogy. Is there any questions, comments, or put downs on this? I don't mind being put down. Go ahead. Push it down if you like. John, is there anything haywire on that thing? How about you? Is there anything that looks reasonable that you experienced it, been doing it? That's quite all right. About time we want to change. Carolyn, you've been doing it for umpteen years? I am. I tried it for many years. It didn't work. So we'll take it off here. And the chore is to change from trying to be non-disturbed to see that I am a grown person now. I'm free to experience whatever may arise in my way today. Now you can do that. You want to experience it anyway. Is that right? If something comes up, we're going to experience it. Might as well do it gracefully. Do it with style. Maybe somebody steps on the toe, somebody calls me a dirty name, somebody bangs around the door and makes a little gesture at me, but so what? Don't bother me. I said, you know, like me, you just have poor taste. I'm not bothered with people with poor taste. Now let's draw this same picture up here. We're going to call this the organization. You know, we're all called organisms, aren't we? We're living organisms. At the moment. So here we're going to have an army. You know, every country has an army. Right? We all have armies. Now, an army is an organization also. You might say an organism. Is that right? So we'll start off with here's the troops. That's all non-com guys, you know. Non-commissioned officers. They're down here just doing whatever somebody hollers for them to do, just like all the cells in our body. If you say for it to write, it writes. Is that right? If you say it to run a little machine over here, it runs a little machine or swears at it because it's not working right. And so on down the line. If you say, comb my hair, it combs your hair. All these little cells take orders. Is that right? And in here you have the intelligence corps. That's the guys that goes out and sees what's going on. Okay? Now they don't give orders to the troops. They send things somewhere else. So here we are same sort of thing. We've got all of our senses and so forth and receiving impressions from the environment all the time and from the troops. We hear about what those cells are calling. And here we have a wise general. Now that's equivalent to us having a life principle that he'll do anything he sees. I don't know how to wiggle his finger, but all I've got to do is wiggle his finger, and he does it. And no problem. Now you can't wiggle that finger. You can bend it, you may break it, but you can't wiggle it like that. That's up to me. I say that the troops need a little nourishment, and I can eat. And you can't eat for me, right? Can't do that. You may cook me a beautiful meal and set it on the table, but who's got to eat it? Me, is that right? So, the intelligence corps just sees what's going on out here from the environment. It's got all kinds of input from troops. Now, they report to the wise general. We have something in us that's equivalent to that, probably far more intelligent than this wise general is, okay? The wise general then gives orders to the troops, okay? And the troops carry it out, and the army progresses along. Now, we lose jillions of little soldiers in here every day and pay no more attention to it than the general does losing a few troops up there. You know, you've got a lot of little cells that die today. Much more gets recruited and gets in the act almost immediately, okay? And we don't give it any thought. It's no big deal that a few of the troops got dissipated today, is that right? You lose a lot of cells every day, and I lose a lot, you do, everybody else does. So now, let's say that this intelligence corps in here decided that they didn't need to go out and look for really what's going on, but they decided to set up a philosophy that the whole thing was never to have to move this whole army. It'd just be everything provided for without any effort on their part, okay? They got to be philosophers instead of spies, okay? So they begin to tell the wise general something that wasn't true. Now the general has only this source to get it. Okay? So what's the general going to do? He's going to give orders based on that false information. That goes down here. Now, what do you think is going to happen to the troops now? So if they see a big army coming over the hill over there, the so-called enemy, and they report that there's a stump ranch over there. You know, it's just where a bunch of lumbermen cut the ranch. There's trees down the left stump. So there's a stump ranch over there. I don't bother with it. So what's the general going to do? Going to have another vodka tonic and enjoy himself. Is that right? Going out there and get things going. What's going to happen to troops? They're going to get slaughtered. Okay. So he tells them the intelligence corps says there is this sub-ranch is a big invading, the real sub-ranch is a big invading army. He goes out, puts these all in full tilt to fight, run up there and get their things and get all the preparation. There's nothing but stumps to fight. So you're going to, morale is going down the tube, is that right? Now, that's the way these poor bunch of troops are all over here when we tell them that we're in a jillions emergency. Have you reported emergency? You're the intelligence corps. Have you reported that you were in an emergency situation umpteen times? A woman called me the other night. She was screaming. And her boyfriend hadn't called her. He told her he would call. And here it was 8 o'clock. And he hadn't called. And she had one of these phones with a call waiting service on it. I wouldn't have one of those either. Then a business agent, he got a business agent, you know, I'm talking. I haven't came to talk to you at the same time. I won't talk to you at the same time. So she said, wait a minute. And when she came back, she said, it was him. And I said, now you just wasted all this beautiful, dramatic display you've been carrying on. Oh man, she was upset. She was climbing the wall, hanging off the ceiling. She was having fits. It's unbelievable. She hasn't died today. Of course, she's limping when she walks, and she's doing a bunch of other things, and she's getting very upset. She's going to be having big diagnoses for long, you know. She's going to some guy, he's going to lay on her, she's got cancer, but some other weird disorder, doesn't matter what. Because she stays in this state most of the time. If it's not one thing, it's another. So you might call that making everything important. But the point is, when you make anything important, you're in a tangle. Is that right? No, it's not important. It may be extremely interesting. It may even be disagreeable. It may be nice. It may be lovely, but I think it might go away. I don't know what all could be going on. Okay. But when you make anything important, you immediately get very anxious. You ever tried that? It's not important. The world was going on thousands years, billions of years before you and I got here, and I got some other news for you. It'll keep on going. We're long gone. You think so, Tom?
Yes, sir.
Was it going along pretty good long before you got here?
As far as I know.
Wonder how they even managed without you being around to see what was wrong. Huh? So now, the wise general will always, let's think this is worthy of writing down. Wise general, or X, in the case we talk about, okay, the essence of the human being, that which you really are, always, not just now and then, but always, does the appropriate thing, and only it knows what it is, appropriate thing, or information form, the information reported. Good. What is the general spirit? It always does the appropriate thing for the information it received, what it got from the intelligence court, okay? Now, if you tell it how terrible something is, it's going to act as though it's terrible. It's going to do the appropriate thing for a terrible situation. It'll fire you all up to fight or run, and you don't have any fighting or running to do. You're all dressed up, nowhere to go, and what have you, you know. So then your body has charged up a tremendous amount of energy, which we're going to get to around a while. It's accumulated and sent a bunch of energy in for heavy activity, and nothing happens. And we know what happens to that then. That energy starts being dissipated through the physical body by doing something never did do before. We call that adaptation. Other people, it's uncomfortable, and other people call that diseases. But it is dis-ease, not it-ease. But it's not disease. You know, there's no disease is sitting up there in the ceiling waiting to see which one of us is going to attack. Is nothing. That's the way it's laid out. And you're a victim of so-and-so. Maybe it's going to just bring Peter and say, oh, Peter looks pretty good. I'm going to bite him. That's John, I'll bite him. That's Bob, I'll bite on him for a while. They sometimes feel like we didn't remember what we did a few hours ago. You know, we don't take any responsibility for what we reported or what we sent in, but we're in the intelligence corps, this little thing it calls itself, I, and has the responsibility to report accurately. Now, not based on some childhood conclusions or any of those sort of things, but on actual what's going on here now at this moment. So, think you can do that, John, today. You're transformed then. Anybody else can do it? Can you do that, Carolyn? That's transformation. You no longer are an infant living in a grown body with a technical education. You are now a grown person. You are a transformed individual. Know that you have the responsibility of looking at a situation and reporting it accurately. Because then Spirit X, whatever you Stewart called it, Life Principle does the appropriate thing for the information it receives, but it'll do the appropriate thing if you hand it in as though you were an infant and you didn't like this right now, so you're going to get the screen. Okay? Or very politely hold it inside so nobody can. Okay? All right, let's have questions, comments, whatever. I'm going to quit talking for a little bit. Now you're going to talk to me for a little bit. Anybody here got a comment? You want to tell me how hard this is? That's the one I used to hear.
But it's so hard. I can't do it.
I'm addicted to the not eyes. We call these things not eyes. They go around acting like they're you, you know, and they tell you all kinds of very things, especially if it's on you. Okay? Let's have the comments now.
Sometimes it's hard to get out of those states.
Huh?
Sometimes it's hard to get out of the states that you're in. Let's say if you're not aware of it.
Well, if you're not aware of it, it's hard to do anything, you know. I wouldn't want to drive down the street with you driving a car if you weren't aware. I don't like broken bones. If I had one, I would experience it freely, but I'm not going to go out and do unusual things like riding with somebody totally unaware. I don't even ride with a drunk, and they're a little bit aware, but not much. Okay? Did you literally ride with a real drunk down the back? You don't like broken bones either, do you? People used to come in and say, how can you stay awake? And you know why I say stay awake, know what you're doing. At the time I was running a big restaurant down in Texas, and we had a meat saw in the back room. One of these big bandsaws would go boom, boom, we'd shove a cow through there and make little pieces out, big pieces. So I'd take them back there and say, well, here's a bone. We took out a loin beef. Cut this up into 1-inch slices on this saw, but go to sleep while you're doing it. You know, they all stay awake while I'm shoving that thing. Because you can shove it through there and it's as safe as it can be, but if you go to sleep, you cut your head off, or an arm, or a finger, or something like that, you know. You're subject to be manipulated by machinery, aren't you? Pay attention when you're around sleeping, you don't go to sleep then, okay? Okay, questions, comments? Or shall we all take a break?
Bob, would you talk about having the central eye wake up and take charge?
That's just what I've been talking about.
But
it can't take charge unless it gets the information. Now look, X don't exist by itself. It made this awareness function and this motor function down here for a very definite purpose. It all works together. If you take... could you have an army with a wise general on it?
Yes.
You could. So where would his troops be? He don't have any troops. I said, could you have an army with the wise general on it? He's just as wise and powerful as he can be, huh? Knows every trick of military science. But he don't have an intelligence corps, and he don't have troops. So to say, to have X take over and run everything while I just sit here and enjoy it is obviously not feasible because the organism has been torn apart. That's what happens after you're dead, and I don't know about that. I haven't followed you around there very much. If you followed anybody through the nether world for a while, we'll finally get back, but I don't know how. So obviously, okay, you have to have all four aspects, or you don't have a human being. You got to have, we'll call it spirit for a lack of a better word. Let's call it essence. I like that word better. That's what can move this finger. Then we have the mental function. Is that right? It's what says, I want the finger to move. And then we have the physical body, which is a piece of dead meat, but these two are not here. Is that right? We say, here lies the remains. We treat it with great respect, but it's just a piece of meat. Huh? Because it's nothing. It's a machinery. It's like a car without a driver or a fueling. And we always have function. Now, that is an organism, is that right? Now, if there's no function, you're not there either, right? Heart's not beating, your eyes are not seeing, your circulation not going on, breath is being pumped in you, you got oxygen, etc. There's a jillion things going on. Now, you can't say, well, what would happen if we just had this? In other words, we have a responsibility. I'm the intelligence core. I live in the vehicle here and experience what it does. Okay? But here's the essence. The essence is essential, but the essence without a mental aptitude to go see what's going on here, the, if we call it here, the intelligence core, the mind general is going to sit. He's going to see his girlfriend or something. I don't know. He's not going to be out there running the army, is he? Is that correct, Don?
That's right.
Okay, so now I'm here. If I want to say that I is the intelligence core or the mental function, that's fine to realize here. This is I with a line drawn under it. This is I with quotation marks around it. And this is something I have to use. And this is the use that I see going on. Now, they all four have to be there, John. I can't say, well, X, you take over, and I'm not going to tell you anything. Let's see what you do. You know what he'll tell me? I'm going to do that. Okay? Because they haven't got anything to do. It's receiving no information. Even if I'm asleep, I got some little feedback going on in there, right? Phone rings in the middle of the night. Hello. That quick.
So where do the not eyes fit in this diagram?
Where did the not eyes? That was the person
about the intelligence core being the awareness and the not eyes filled.
Okay, the same old boys in here. You got the ones that said, we don't have to go in here and see what's going on. We can philosophize about it.
Okay, so we get rid of the not eyes by going through this transformation. What army have you got left?
You've got an intelligence core that knows what it's doing. It's taking on its rightful occupation, reporting what is without judging it. Okay? So the not eyes are really judges, is that correct? One says what you should do is complain. What you should do is stick up for your rights. What you should do is find out who's to blame. A plane crashes in the country, the U.S., I'm sure they do it here too. What's the first thing they do?
Find out who's to blame.
They call in a big crew from Washington who go out there and comb through the wreckage to determine why it happened. That's really going to help everybody on that plane. The next one will be different anyway, right? They're going to see what to blame. What was the cause? When we say cause, we're saying what was to blame for it, is that right? So basically, that's the way it works. So yes, your not eyes disappear when you change their structure. Their structure was based on the whole purpose of living is to be non-disturbed. If I kick that out, what's the not I got to do? Daddy isn't there anymore. He can't function without Dad's feeding him.
Yeah, but the awareness function, just as awareness is just aware. The rest of it is the body. It's the experiencing, going
the
through the awareness.
Just a function, just like that thing you're playing with there. If you push the button and turn the current off, then you tell me what that thing's doing then.
Well, it won't be doing nothing except being
there. That's right.
Right.
And
but be aware.
If you didn't program it to do something, it wouldn't do nothing either. So here the not eyes are the expression of that basic idea that the whole purpose of living is to be non-disturbed or to regain the non-disturbed state. The non-eyes all die when you move down. Just like the dog dies, the ticks all die when the dog dies. and so on down the line. They're parasites. They're just ways of expressing that the whole purpose of living is to be non-disturbed. So the Nanites go, they are not entities, they act like entities while Papa's alive. But if you throw Papa out, the kids go with him. So if you throw out your favorite tenant, he takes all of his family with him, okay? You ready to deal with that? Right now.
I think what we're looking for is complicated solutions to simple problems.
That is absolutely correct. You want to complicate and philosophize instead of say, hey, this is a simple thing. It is simple. I didn't say it was easy, but I can sure do it. I don't have to go around with my whole purpose of living being to be non-disturbed. Sure, I have things that's not comfortable every day in the world. Who don't? But you know, some things have many days not comfortable. Even the best of days you have a few. Don't you? You have a few things uncomfortable. So what? I just report it's uncomfortable and going about my business. I'm going to experience it gracefully, freely. I'm not going to jump up and down because now it's my turn to feel a little sick, you know.
Bob.
Yeah.
Getting back to my point, the awareness is aware. I can be aware that Leanne is sitting there and Brian is sitting there and you're at the front of the room. That doesn't do anything. That's just an awareness.
That's right.
Somewhere in there, there is a function which has to place some kind of value on whatever
is happening.
That's
absolutely correct.
Now, so, that is being placed by something. It's, I don't know.
The way
my experience is that the awareness is only aware of it. But the place of value is not just the awareness.
It is one of them. Now, valuing is based upon experience of the awareness. Now, if the awareness never had any experience, it would have no valuing system. But you always have a value, and the awareness job is to place values, comparative value, on different things. So, we go in a restaurant and they hand us a menu, okay? And it's got a bunch of items listed on it. And maybe at that moment I would decide on the item here for, because I've never had it before. I'll try that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I'll put a value on it. I'll see what it is. I may never order it again. That may be the last time, but I gather experience.
Right.
Now, we function by experience. We're going to get to that after a while about people going around asking all kinds of why questions. But let's say that you've got a brain that's, everybody ever noticed it, it's got a big glob over here and a glob over here, it's got a little thing running between them. Call those associative fibers. So you run into something and you stuck your finger in on a hot stove one time or another, or a hot utensil off the stove. You know, it's remarkable how well you will value kind of touching the thing the next time before you grab it, because that sets up an association between memory and not. So I meet one of you on the street 5 years from now, say, and you say, hello, Bob, how are you? And I would say, I'm fine, and how's all your wellness getting along lovely? And I'm just going to keep on talking. I know I've met her before and walked with her name. Now that information is recorded over here. And so the little guy on that side that just now come in and says, oh, and I go down the street and say, what was her name? And he goes knocking on every little cell door in there. There's a few big of them, you know. So he knocks on the door and says, who is that girl? Search me. Knocks me. Search me. Search me. Finally it hits the one, oh, yes. You saw her in Vancouver. And it feels like a great relief when I got the information. It's worthless because I was gone 2 weeks before it got here. Worthless bit of information was a great relief. Did you ever have that happen?
Yeah.
Huh? Maybe 2 weeks later and you're brushing your teeth, it pumps up. Oh, yeah. That's who that was. Great relief, isn't it? Because all this activity has been going on. This little guy's been running. The file clerk has been running, knocking on every little cell door. Hey, who is it, girl? Who is it, girl? Who is it, girl? Who is it? search me, I don't know. No, it's not recorded here. Now you ask the question, there's nothing recorded in there. You really a freak. It'll rattle from now on. That's called an infinite loop. You know that, you burn them up. Put an infinite loop in it, you'll ruin the computer. They call it putting a virus in these days. The guy on his software puts one in there that can't be answered because there's no data in there. And it'll run until it destroys everything. It'll just keep going. So, yes, you develop the awareness function, the intelligence core develops the value system. If this intelligence core is any good, they're going to report there's an army coming. They can do that real fast. If they see a sub-branch over there, they say, well, we'll put that in the daily report. Later today, don't mean anything one way or the other. If there's flood, they will report it, get with it, the flood, and not be advised the troops, and so on down the line. Yes, you awareness, the intelligence core, is a valuing system as well as just looking at it. Okay? In other words, I meet some people, I stop and say hello and howdy doody and shake hands with them, and others, I just keep moving on. I don't have any value connected with them. Some of these people, I have pretty good values hooked on. In fact, I may have a lot of value hooked on me. Okay. So the value.
So you're saying intelligence and awareness are the same thing. I mean, I know a lot of people that have worked with this, some of this work, and they have observed things that they keep repeating and they keep repeating, but they don't do anything about it.
That's what I just said. They don't ever change the basic decision, so they just keep on with the same pattern. They get drunk every Saturday night, and after a while they get drunk on Saturday and Sunday night, and then pretty soon they're drunk 7 nights a week. Don't sweat.
But that's the awareness. That's just they're aware that they're doing it.
No, it's not. That is that basic decision that we said screwed up the intelligence. Okay, and if we don't get it out of there, we got a bug in there. And when it's bugged, you don't do anything. So, you have an intelligence core. We'll draw a clean one here. Now, here is experience, life, function. Here is the intelligence core, and here's the troops down here, or the physical body. And here's the function. You got four things going. They have to be working together. If this one is all screwed up by having no value or a false value that's putting out, after all, that was a false value, a misconception is a false value. So certainly they're receiving impressions from here, and they also have stored up the experience in their file so they can push a button and runs up file number F3. Your computer's got files numbers on it, doesn't it? Sure. You call anything back up, random access memory, here we go, get it, boom, 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 right now. So you have it up there, but there is a value included on these. But now if the overpowering value, the only value you had was to be non-disturbed, then those others all get secondary. So the guy who gets drunk on Saturday he's bored on Saturday, he don't go to work that day and what have you, so he doesn't run and get drunk. Well, next week he still wants to be non-disturbed, so he does that, and after a while that hangs over little brother, and that produces disturbance itself, so he tries some more. And pretty soon he can be a full-fledged alcoholic. He has still trying to be non-disturbed. Once that decision is gone, then you can have a whole different set of values altogether, okay? Because that's your overpowering valuing system. The whole purpose of living is to regain the non-disturbed state. That's your value. So you can spend time, effort, money, hours, sickness, everything else. Now, I know people who repeatedly get sick. Don't you?
Yeah.
They keep on doing the same thing, made them sick. I used to practice as a physician 15 years ago, and I had a lot of people that came to me and they wanted to get all right. Well, they did. some things or other which relieve the symptom for the time being. And you know the only reason they wanted the symptom relieved, so they could do what brought it on in the first place. And they went and did it again, and again, and again. Same people had chairs leased in my reception room for years. I knew who to look at for on Tuesday morning, I was going in there. So I couldn't get rid of them, so I'd move. They had to find something else. Then I'd start to cycle all over again. Got another bunch of people sitting there leasing chairs in the reception room. Same difference. And they'd always get about the same thing. And I would tell them that if you change your lifestyle, you're liable to get all right. You get me well, regardless of what I did. Well, okay, I'll fix you up so you feel better. You just need to know. It's all good. If I'm still good, help me out. Feel all right. On good again. So one day I said, can't move anymore. I will quit. And I quit. I've been back since you. And I'm going to.
So did you say that intelligence and awareness were or were not the same thing?
Intelligence is X. Awareness.
It takes intelligence to decide what is and is not valuable. I mean, that's not just awareness. Awareness could be, I'm aware that there's a car going by.
Well, you were painting a very different, you're using a very narrow description of intelligence or awareness, and I use a much broader one. I just told you mine. You can paint yours, and I won't buy it. Okay. It's all hooked together.
Yeah.
It works as a unit, I told
right.
you. Is that right?
Right.
So it's going to be there. Now, you're going to gain certain experience. You told me about an experience you ground. We was looking through that thing last night, and all the images looked pleasant. You said you took the tape home, and it looked beautiful run on the machine.
Right.
Is that right? Now, you gain some awareness of how it works.
Right.
So you're going to value that you don't spend half the night trying to make the image look good when it's supposed to look like it does. When you take it home, it runs off and that's better. Okay?
Right.
Okay. These things are not four separate things. There are four aspects and they all work together. Okay? If you have no body, you wouldn't have any values either. Okay? But you have one, so don't rattle around about that. One time, Justin, that was before that, with Justin. He was so good it hurt. Came down to visit me and I said, he's living on planet Earth, let's be a little earthy. He's been doing better ever since. Don't make me hurt when I'm around him. Let's have more fun too than us. Okay, let's take a break for a little bit. It's about wanted to continue to discuss this one. I'm very thankful because it's the most valuable picture in the world. Let's get it down to that to where we see what it's at. And so the whole purpose for us to be on planet Earth seems to be that we are to gain experience. Now experience equals knowledge first, and knowledge will and experience will equal wisdom. That's good stuff. They're helping. Have a little wisdom. Now, without experience, we couldn't have any value system whatsoever. Unless we just philosophize on one. All right, Justin?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so as we gain experience, so the function of awareness is first to sense, but that's just part of it. We sense it, then we experience it, and then we value. Everything we have ever run into, we have placed a value on. Most of us have totally forgotten that, but we do. Okay? You do place a value on it. You place a value on certain people. you place a value on being away from certain people. Right? And you place a value on being around them. And you place a value on various things that you have found interesting or delightful to you. You could find a certain food. You might decide it was delightful to you. Maybe you'll find a certain brand of something you like. And you put a value on having that again. Is that right? You may put a value on never getting it again, too. So the awareness function is where we do the experiencing and the valuing, and which turns up finally with having wisdom, because then it can receive directly from X, or the life principle, or spirit, or whatever word you want to use. It opens the door. It's only when the awareness function can be still, and it can only be still when it is no longer trying to be non-disturbed. When it's still, there's a flow here, there's a flow here, there's a flow here, there's a flow here, and there's a flow here. Now those all go on. Now you recall integrated or whole or transformed or what have you. Now, the way of being in contact with X, which is the intelligent, is that you have to be have a quiet mind. Now, you don't have a quiet mind when you are struggling to be not disturbed. Is that right? If you're not disturbed at the moment, you're afraid you will be. And if you are, you're afraid you won't get non-disturbed. And so there's never a quiet mind going on. Now, a quiet mind exists when I'm free to experience what's going on and I'm not struggling to be non-disturbed in any shape, manner, form, or fashion, then your mind goes quiet most of the time. And that's called peace also. It's peaceful. And having a quiet mind is considered the greatest attribute of the human being, because that's the only way you can be in total communication with the source of all being, which is life. Because it is so polite, it's not going to come barging in and start, hey, listen to me for a while. You're going to be in a quiet state, and then it talks to you very nicely and tells you lots of wonderful things. I can't tell you what they are, because it probably tells everybody something different. Because everybody is different. Everybody has a different expression and is a unique work of art. So it's always expressing, but it does express at all times when you have a quiet mind. You have a quiet mind when you're not struggling to be non-disturbed or to gain pleasure and escape pain. When you're trying to escape or gain, you don't have a quiet mind. Okay, now we'll go on with more questions here on this subject if we'd like.
If I change my purpose, Dr. Bob, does that mean that essentially all the experiences that I built up based on the previous purpose, that they're basically...
They're wiped out. When you change the purpose, everything connected with it is wiped out, sure.
So you're basically starting again to build up experiences.
Well, sure, you start out. So if you have a purpose to be quiet, we'll say, when you're doing something different than you were when you were trying to fight the world, is that right? Mm-hmm. You know about fighting the world, don't you?
Oh, yes.
When you quit trying to fight with it, it's remarkable how nice it gets out there. They let you alone. The world lets you alone pretty well when you quit fighting with it, right?
Right.
So we'll talk on purpose later today. But now I've got that on my little cheat sheet. Says that one subject we might cross by today. My only cheat sheets are the name of the subject. So I've got on there one on purpose, so we'll kick it around this afternoon, okay? All right, is there any other comments on this one? Justin, go right ahead. Here, you got it.
Oh, me first.
You got the first one.
I just wanted to know what that wisdom was.
What is wisdom?
I've heard it a lot. I don't know what it means.
Well, I'd say that's one you need to experience, not get a definition of, but wisdom is possibly seeing things as they really are. Not through a fog of old conclusions, okay?
Wisdom sounds like it's something you earn, you know?
Well, it's not. It's a gifting.
Yeah.
when you get out of the way, is already there. In other words, you already have it, but it can't express until we're no longer struggling to be non-disturbed. In other words, you won't develop any attribute. You may develop the attribute, but it's already there, or it won't develop. But it's like we mentioned one time, if you found a pot of gold with your little metal detector out here in the wild somewheres, and all you got to do to it is get the dirt off. The gold is already there in the can. All you got to do is move the earth off of it so you can get to it. Is that right? Wisdom is the same way. It's here. Everybody has a fair supply, except they can't ever see things like it really is, because they're looking through a lens of wanting to be non-disturbed. We'll try to make a little drawing. I like little drawings. So we'll say you're looking at your eyeball here, and here is an object over here like this. But there's a lens in here that's very distorted, like one of those in the farm where you go out and look at it and you're short and fat, or you're tall and skinny, or what have you, you know. So you're distorted through this lens of false purpose. That's the lens. Then you won't see a square over here like this. You will see something maybe looks like that. So you're not seeing as it really is. And to see as it really is means we've gotten the limbs out of the way. And then that is called the wisdom, I believe.
Yeah, you disidentify there.
Yeah, you disidentify from all these ideas or purposes that you previously had, which the only real purpose most people ever had was to be non-disturbed. It's expressed lots of ways. One person tells me, if I just had love in my life, I'd be all right. Another one just says, if I got this person out of my life, I'd be all right. Another one says that if I won the lottery, why, I'd be all right. Another one says this. All of them instill some way of saying, if I was not disturbed, I'd be all right. Okay? That's the one that prevents wisdom. Wisdom is a natural attribute of a human being. If, yes.
The false purpose the same as an illusion?
Yeah, it's an illusion. So the false purpose is that the purpose of living is to be non-disturbed, or, you know, you can break it down into all the things that any of us could come up with. I'd be non-disturbed if I had this. I do happen to know a young man who, he and another person split the lottery in California something like $34 million. He was a sacker in a grocery store, you know, the guy that puts the groceries in the bag and hands them to you after the checker gets through with them. And he lived at home with his folks. He's 32 years old. And he's really got problems now. He was doing all right when he was just going home, sacking groceries, but he got problems now. He's really got problems. He's made it that very important to do the right thing with that money. And he hasn't had a night's sleep since he won the thing.
It's a lot of money.
Yeah, it is. Ooh. And he can't have fun with it yet. Maybe he will. We're trying to talk to him and have a little fun with it. We're all going to have a good income the rest of his life. Put it out at 3% interest. Is that right, John?
That's right.
It's only about 3%. You live fantastic, but I've still got the gap. Well, we can't tell him that. No, that's Steve.
Is he still bagging groceries?
No, he did quit that. Probably misses it a lot. Okay, your question here.
Well, I just asked the one.
You got it. Okay, well, you learned one about wisdom. Okay, so wisdom is being able to see a thing as it is. So you can apply everything we've talked about today. If you walk out on the street today, you can experience it. You walk in off the street, you can experience it. It's going on all around me, John. And we get false ideas as to how everything would work sometimes. We figure if I could just do this or I could do that, everything worked fine. Works fine when you can finally give.
The false purpose the same as an illusion?
Yeah, it's an illusion. So the false purpose is that the purpose of living is to be non-disturbed, or, you know, you can break it down into all the things that any of us could come up with. I'd be non-disturbed if I had this. I do happen to know a young man who, he and another person split the lottery in California something like $34 million. He was a sacker in a grocery store, you know, the guy that puts the groceries in the bag and has to do you after the checker is through with them. And he lived at home with his folks. He's 32 years old. And he's really got problems now. He was doing all right when he was just going home, sacking groceries, but he got problems now. He's really got problems. He's made it that very important to do the right thing with that money. And he hasn't had a night's sleep since you won the thing.
It's a lot of money.
Yeah, it is. Ooh. And he can't have fun with it yet. Maybe he will. We'll try and talk to him and have a little fun with it. For all of you, have a good income the rest of your life. It's just put it out at 3% interest. Is that right, John?
That's right.
They put it out 3%. You live fantastic, but I've still got to get. Well, we try and tell him that. And I stay.
Is he still bagging groceries?
No, he did quit that. Probably misses a lot.
Yeah.
Okay, your question here.
Well, I just asked the one.
You got it. Okay, we learned one about wisdom. Okay, so wisdom is being able to see a thing as it is. So you can apply everything we've talked about today. If you walk out on the street today, you can experience it. You walk in off the street, you can experience it. It's going on all around us, John. And we get false ideas as to how everything would work sometimes. We figure if I could just do this or I could do that, everything works fine. Works fine when you can finally give up the whole idea that you've got to be non-disturbed. It really, it's all false in place then. That's the whole bit. Now, I have people come in, somebody come the other day and said, I want to surrender. I want, you know, he heard a book somewhere that talked about surrender. So he came for an hour appointment from San Francisco to the Grove down. All set and set and talked for an hour. Okay. That surrender was to be free to experience whatever arises today. He looked at me and said, well, go on. So isn't that surrender? I'm free to experience whatever may arise in my way today, and I'm going to experience it anyway. Might as well do it nicely and grin. All right? Might as well laugh about it and do something. So he's having a fit over this gun. I'm going to experience it anyway if it happens to me. So, that's all you can do about it is experience it freely, and you can usually see that you not put a great value on trying to duplicate a lot of them. I've never done that, but you'll automatically duplicate them if you're still dealing with the same old purpose all the time, being non-disturbed. You'll just automatically duplicate them, or, you know, you got a pattern going. I know one lady who married 5 men in a row, all were alcoholics. Now she didn't like that. Her dad was an alcoholic, so she always maintained she never had anything to do with alcoholics. But for some reason or other, she married 5 in a row. You know, she had a pattern. So they found out the real problem was she was addicted to wedding cake, so
because they were rum filled.
That's all we bothered her. That's it. So, now that we've got that pretty well taken care of, I believe, on this picture?
I'm trying to formulate this question because there's a number of factors. One of them is the what has been referred to, although we haven't talked about it in this workshop, is the I don't know department.
Well,
the process of judging what experience is or is not valuable.
All experience is valuable if you see it as experience and not just enduring it. Most people don't experience anything in life, they just endure a lot. The experiencing is where you can come up with judgment. Now, there's a bunch of things that people ask questions that I say, well, I put those in the I don't know department. Now, somebody comes along and tells me all about, or asks me about what happens after you die. I said, well, usually they bury the body. But they want some other theory. Well, I have to say, I don't know. Does anybody here know? Been there? You? I don't know. Let's say I don't know. Some people get bee stung and they nearly die, and some of them flip it off as though nothing happened. So somebody says, what'll happen if the bee stings? I don't know. You? I don't know the person or the person circumstance that found the bee stung or what have you. So I'm put in, I don't know. Somebody says, how long will it take me to get well? I'm very sick. I don't know. How long will it take me? A man called me the other day from over on the East Coast, and he said he went to a doctor that day, and they told him he had 3 months to live. Now, he's been going a long time, so he went down there. He got a diagnosis. 3 months. So I said, well, I wouldn't quite buy that. I go see another one, see what he says. So 2 days later, he goes to another one. That one told him he lived 6 months.
Better.
He get better all the time. I didn't mention that yet. I said, well, I'll still get a third of it. So he went to see another one, and the guy said he lived at least a year. So he called me and told me about it, all with his sad voice, I'm going to die, you know. Not that something everybody does. We all got a fatal disorder, you know, in terminal condition. We were born. That's terrible. So when he called and told me he had a year, I said, well, you're sure getting better fast. You went from 3 months to live to 6 months to live, and now here 2 days later, you got a year to live. He said, well, I feel like I went to Las Vegas and won the jackpot. I did. He's getting better every day. So now he's like, I'm getting one for 5 years. Who knows? So that's experiencing. Experiencing, you learn to value. So real learning how to learn is learning from experience, which you are experiencing freely, not under duress. You don't learn anything from anything you experience under duress or while you are not conscious of what you're doing. You don't learn anything from that. But from experience, you learn a valuing system. And that's a part of it. And the awareness is not just aware there is a camera there, or there's a lovely lady over here, or that there's a man over here making notes. It is what we are experiencing from those things, and what value we are coming up with, and so forth. So this is the value place, where the values take place is in here. X could care less, it seems. Mm-hmm. This one up here could care less what you value or don't value. It's all right. If you value eating caviar, well, you don't have caviar down here. If you can't stand caviar, it'll get along with that just as well. So forth. If you like country western music, it'll go along fine with that. If you like the highest classical music in the world, it'll go along fine with that. Doesn't care. Because it seems to be static anyway. And this over here is the body. That's what you, is the sensory. It picks up the senses and X uses it to express activity with. So this doesn't just have one little limited situation. This doesn't just have one little limited thing, and X is unlimited. So what it does. And the function will always be in accord of how well this is organized. And that's what we're talking about. We're talking about the big
this organizer of it is trying to live in a grown being as though we were an infant, still trying to be non-disturbed. Even there's the infant out there, that's right, there's a minor thing to be non-disturbed. Now we get gossip out there. Okay, let's take a little lunch, excuse me.
Where does liking and disliking fit in? I mean, obviously,
that's just taste. That taste is a part of awareness. That's your individuality. You are an individual, not one out of ten. Just
right.
Like you're different. You will have a different taste. You will like parts of music. You will like different foods. You will like different surroundings. You like different shirts, obviously. And now.
Why, thank you, Bob.
And you can go on and on and on as to all the things that you're an individual.
Right.
And you will have certain tastes, and that taste is absolutely perfect for you, and it may not be well for any of the rest of us.
So liking and disliking are distinct from the purpose. Or
oh, no, it has nothing to do with it. And did you ever notice that sometimes things you used to dislike a long time ago, you like now and vice versa? Or if you live long enough to get them. You have. You've been around long enough to know. You know, I remember things that I just couldn't stand to eat a long time ago. Now then, I'm laughing up. Also, there was a bunch of things that I liked then and don't even go near now. So, your taste is subject to change, really, without notice. You can watch most guys, you can see them change girlfriends that way, so you know they have different tastes at different times. One they would like blondes, another redheads, another one they like brunettes. Sometimes they can get so they don't like any for a little while, and then they start all over again, and so forth. This your taste is subject to change, but taste is a mark of individuality.
Right.
So everybody here, if we lined up to say we all went in order to steak in the steakhouse, okay?
Mm-hmm.
I'm paying the bill, so you can order everything you want, whatever you want. Some will order them well done, some of them will order them medium rare, some of them will order them medium, some of them will want New York, some will want porterhouses, some will want top sirloin, some will want ribeyes, and on down the road, because everybody will have a different taste. If I served them all medium rare New York, some of them would be very upset. I took a girl out to dinner one time years and years ago. And I ordered a steak medium rare. And I kept noticing that she was looking over this way while I'm being done. And I finally said, "What's the matter? Is something bothering you?" And she said, "I've branded critters that got up and run off. It hurt worse than that." She couldn't stand to see it. She was from the area where you want me. You want it well done. Okay? And I wouldn't bother. I'd throw it away. But on me.
So liking is distinct from values. In other words.
Oh, no, that has nothing to do with it. Like and dislike. It's a matter of taste. It has nothing to do with values. Maybe you order your steak medium rare for a while and then you order it some other way. Is that right? And you used to put sugar in your coffee. No, you don't put sugar in your coffee. It tastes the same. So on down the line. Some like cream and sugar in your coffee. That changes. Then I drink it all black. Some like it weak and then they get strong. So some of them drink vodka and then they start drinking wine or whatever. Who cares? That's a matter of taste. And it does vary with the same individual. And it certainly varies from individual to individual.
Mm-hmm. But you can place a value on what you like.
Oh, sure. I'm going in and ordering something to eat that I flat don't like. Mama didn't raise any stupid kid. Not going to fight that. But if my taste changes, then I'll order what else it changed to, okay?
Mm-hmm.
I don't feel obligated to go back and do it like I did years ago or whatever it was. But that has nothing to do with value of the system. Sure, I'm going to order what I like. Best of my ability. I'm going to live where I like. I like everywhere, so I live about everywhere. So, you know, but it's sometimes I like clothes a certain color. I always wear all kinds of colors. I got never color, but sometimes I prefer the brown. Maybe for 2 weeks, maybe for a month, and then I don't want to brown on for weeks and weeks and weeks. I'll wear something on. So then, but while I'm feeling nice and brown, I'm going to wear brown. Okay, let's take a little lunch break, and we will get back at 2 o'clock. I will start promptly at 2. You're here, fine. I'll start with you, and I hope you all are. If you're not, I'll start anyway, okay? And we will go till we get through. Whatever time that may be. Somebody.
Sexuality and spirituality.
Sexuality and spirituality. Well, all right. That'll be good subject. Mm-hmm. I'll leave the alities off and just put two there, okay? All right. Okay, we'll just go with the straight stuff. So, generally speaking, if these are both being used as they are designed, they're the same thing. However, sometimes both of them are perverted a little bit. So sometimes sex is used as a distraction, as we were talking about a little while ago, keep going. And that doesn't have much spirit involved in it, if any. And many, many times it is used purely as a distraction to keep from thinking about what the whole purpose of living or anything would be. So then sex becomes a very mundane affair and is not an expression of life at all, but just what it is. Spiritual is also used much the same way, that some people only think that spirit ought to be magic and they use different things to try to achieve a magical state of being by thinking they call it a spirit. Most often, as I see it, it turns out in many places I look and see as that it is suggestibility, or the use of suggestion to achieve a phenomena of some sort or other. And using suggestion are to only try to achieve a magical formula or to have something that I think will be non-disturbed and so forth is about as perverted as sex is when used only as a distraction or an entertainment factor. Okay? So, in its true state, where there is really, shall we say, love, which is the basic attribute of spirit, is love. We're not talking about the pure erotica love. Love has four words that out of the ancient Greek language has all been translated into love, so there's considerable. So the first one we'll put is pi. That's the love for your shall we say your family. You may fuss at your little girl, but nobody else better cry. Is that about right? That's pie. You protect her if you had to fight us all, even though you just got through scolding her. So pie is the love of the simplest term of parent-child, but it also includes several other relatives and etc. that you could say entire family. The next one is eros, which is an instinct to mate, okay, no matter what. That is the love mating, not just seeing if we could find a quick pickup down at the corner bar and have some distraction for a little while. The next one is philia, which means I like. So you like certain people far more than you do others, and you can explain why and don't care why, just you do, okay? You also like certain foods, you like certain buildings, you like certain means of transportation. You look at a car, you say, I just love that car. And all of this just means I like. Now this we share with all higher mammals, period. The cat has it, and the cow has it, and the pig has it, and everything else in the world. All the mammals have it, okay?
kids go out and check that out anytime you please. They have their likes, dislikes, they'll fight for their young, they will mate, etc. Okay? Now that kind of love without this next one is not real human love. And this is agape. And then put it in its simplest terms, it says, I can see that whatever you do, whatever I do, whatever anyone else does, that at the moment of doing, they felt whatever they were doing was right, proper, and justifiable with what they had. Did you ever try to do something you couldn't justify? Huh? You know, we frequently, I think our entire criminal system is based on you knew what was right, but you went on and did wrong anyway. Well, it may have, you thought it was right, but you didn't, you had to justify it. You may have thought something wasn't right, but you justified it. Now, we said when it feels right or proper or justifiable, correct? So, we can justify about anything for a few minutes, especially if we're working on those things we saw as the basic purpose this morning, and it's important to get over all disturbance, and somebody disturbs me, it may be justifiable to shoot him at that moment. But if we are a little more enlightened, we don't feel justified in that. We recognize the person felt justified, and so if the person feels something is right, proper, and justifiable, you can't very well fuss at him about it. So we leave him alone, we now judge. That comes before it said judge not anywhere, so I don't put anybody down as being a bad person because they have to do what I do. I feel it's right, proper, and justifiable. And of course we are taught many things to be able to justify. So we all have that. You hurt mine, you stepped on my toe, I'll step on yours, or I'll knock your head off, or something like that. But if you have agape, and then you had eros, you would have a spiritual union. So that would be altogether different than, as we said, you can make it pick up down the bar, it's all over with. That is merely a distraction, and it's not love, and it's not even sexuality. Don't be blunt about it. It's just distraction. But if you put these two together, you really have agape for the person, you have eros for the person, then you can have love. And that is altogether different. It grows instead of detracts. Now, if you find two people every once in a while say they fell in love, that always makes me laugh. But they fell in love. So what they did was they had a good charge of eros going along. It's strictly out of hormones. And when the hormones get gratified after a while, where there is no attraction, and then we see all the funny things that goes on between two people with when the hormones get used up for a while. You know, they can't be used. But if there's real love, it grows. And if there's only this distraction or gratification factor there, it wears out after a while. And they fall out of love. It can all be handled with a little shot of hormone. So that don't matter very much. Does that help answer your question all right?
Mm-hmm.
Good enough. We'll wrap it off there and leave it.
Dr. Bob, I got a little bit lost in your discussion of justifying when you're talking about it.
All right. Right, proper, or... rights are proper, are justified. Now, did you ever steal anything in your life?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah. And at that moment you felt justified in doing it. Now, usually the thing about justification is that not very long after it happens, the justification breaks down. And then you felt guilty or scared that you'd get caught or umpteen other little things come along. Is that about right? So justification is always very temporary. So one time down in New Mexico, I worked with all four-time losers, four-time felon men. New Mexico gives you life imprisonment without parole. so the court's trying to be as lenient as possible and not have the jails running over, the main thing, was that when somebody was picked up on the fourth one, they had a choice of going to court or coming to see me. Which one would you take? I have learned to pass things off. So all these guys come in, and ones that I had, they were all happened to be men that I had, didn't have any women, that was four-type losers. So every one of them had a perfect justification for their activity, okay? Long, real loud thing that they could justify. Now, if you feel you have been mistreated in this world, or you have been unfortunate, or 101 other things, you can listen to a little not-I, one of those things we had on there, the complainer, the sticker up for the right, to the blamer. And he'll tell you it's very justifiable to do it. Now, while he's talking, that one on the other side says you got to please everybody and do as you're told by your authorities and improve yourself, he went to get a short beer. And so he leaves you entirely up to this guy that's telling you how justifiable it is, okay?
Okay.
So then you go do it, huh?
What does that have to do with the Godhead?
Well, not a whole lot, except I understand that everybody has those justifications. That is part of agape. I said agape says, in its simplest way of stating it, and I like simple things, I see or understand that you, he, they, I, anybody else, at the moment of doing something, felt it to be right or proper or justified. Okay? Got it all now? So then I can't go around and judge him as being a dirty old man or any of the other things, bad person, a thief or a robber. Because I don't know what I might be able to justify sometime or other. I think having not any more determined that I need to be totally non-disturbed any time, I don't have much justification. So I'm left to doing what seems right or proper to me. Okay? I can't get any good justifications going. It just won't work anymore. So if you need to have some justification, don't go any further. It's liable to get a part on you one of these days, and then you can't justify, okay? So when we're without justification, we simply see things that it's over here. So I wouldn't think of being honest. I don't even think of that. I don't know anything about it. Okay? I don't know anything about being goody good or anything of that kind of stuff. Goody, 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 you know those kind of people, don't you? But I simply do what I feel is to my advantage. Now, if you look at that, you'd probably say that's selfish, is that right? I think it's clever and kind of selfish.
Then describe that way.
Right, selfish. Now, out here in the world every day, we have made selfish and greed a synonym. That's not right? To me, they're very different. And I would love to live in a world where everybody was constantly, consciously selfish. Okay? Because they'd be doing what they felt was to their advantage. Now, I've never felt it to be my advantage since I got that looked at to steal from anybody or to take undue advantage of them in any way, okay? I'm going to do what's to my advantage. It's not to my advantage, the best I can say, to ever harm anyone. Would that be about right? I can't ever see that to be to my advantage, so being selfish, I don't do it. Huh? Not because I'm honest or good or what?
I have a question. This is getting to something of particular interest to me, and that is dealing office politics.
Yeah.
Where when you're dealing with office politics, it often seems on the surface to me that sometimes one supervisor might do just that. Mm-hmm. Might appear to his advantage, take advantage or to
well, he has to look at it. He is still working down here on the greed bit.
Uh-huh.
greed and selfish is two different things. A greedy person could say, this looks like it's to my advantage to put this guy out or do so-and-so so I can get ahead. That's not to his advantage if he is awake enough to look at anything. Never is. If he wants a promotion, you know what he best do? Prepare somebody to fill his shoes instead of trying to keep anybody that looks like his halfway competent out of the way. You've seen that one over and over. You have too. So that's a greedy person. Now, we said that there is a decided difference between greed and selfish, even though they have been made synonyms in the general everyday world. So he's still thinking in terms of greed, that which he wants to get to keep somebody else from getting it. The first step in common law, which is what most of other laws are supposed to be built on or not, number one says that I will do what I promise to do. If I tell you I'll do so-and-so and take hands, I'll do that. Okay? The second is I won't transgress against any other person in any way. So the person who is selfish would know at least those two fundamentals of human law. Okay? And if you do that, you're not going to do those things like you're talking about office politics. I'm well acquainted with that stuff too. But those are greedy guys, not selfish. Okay, what's full up?
Yep.
And they're always do themselves in over a period of time. At first they look like maybe they got on, they stepped on somebody's shoulder and neck and thought they did well, but if you just stick around for a while and watch, I've had that one little advantage. I've been around here a long time. So sooner or later it kind of goes. That's the way it happens on there. Okay, now, got another question, one point we wanted to talk about a minute? Done.
What's wrong with distraction?
Nothing. Except I don't need it. I don't pay a lot of money for something I don't need to use.
I've been known to.
Yes, okay. So there's nothing wrong with it. There's nothing wrong with entertainment. As far as I'm concerned, distraction. I'm putting off and looking at myself to see what I really am. Is that all right? That's the only thing I see. There's nothing wrong with entertainment. I love beautiful entertainment. I love to listen to beautiful music. I love to see a lot of things. There's some things that people call entertainment that I'm not interested in. But nothing wrong with anything, John. It's just what's it doing to you. Okay. So if I'm running for distraction, all I'm doing is putting off looking at myself, see what's really going on in there, which is what we talked about all morning. Okay, if all the questions are up for the moment, is there any more? We'll talk about another little thing. We'll even take sex and spirit off of here. And we'll talk about two worlds. You've probably heard of the statement, and most of us have read something or other in esoteric literature. It usually says that we're in this world, but not of it. That heard around, everybody heard that statement. So let's see, we're here. So I can be of, and I want to know what world I'm of, and what world I'm in. In this world, but not of it. So I want to know which one I'm in, which one I'm really of. Okay. So there's two worlds. The first world is the world. We'll call that the man-made world. People made man-made world. They created and made a world of ideas, ideals. Machines, games, etc. Okay? Now the real world over here we'll call the real world, which is the one we're of. Real world. The world of real living beings.
two of which are exactly alike. I don't care if you got identical twins or whatever, they have different fingerprints, they have doing other differences inside and out. You know identical twins, they're very different. One is bossy, the other is very neat, etc., etc., etc. So, a world of real living beings, no two of which are alike. This is the world we are of. But we live in this world over here all the time. This is where we are. So we're in it, but not of it. So the world of these things all have standards. So if I come up with some idea and I go out and teach it to a bunch of people, then I give them an examination to see how well they can regurgitate it back to me to see how good they are. Is that right? And they give you a grade of A plus, A minus, A and B, C's, D's and F's. So you didn't play it back right. The ideals comes up the same way. There's all kinds of people have ideals and they fight and contend over those. We have big expensive political campaigns all about somebody saying what the ideal is. Is that right? We have groups that go up with one ideal and they are demonstrating against another group that's got some other ideal. Is that right? And this goes on and on and on and on. As far as we're concerned, just don't get involved in it, okay? So what? They can all have their things, they can get their banners, and they can march, and they can do all their things. Now, if you have a machine of any kind, you have a standard for it. Couldn't get along without it. So, our clothing are mostly little machines. I've got a portable house on, got little portable floors under my feet. So I can call up the place and say I need a size so-and-so shoe and will you drop it on me? And because it's got the standard measurements, I can get it and wear it. It's in the material. We don't have to have everything custom made and go to the store and get it, right? So if you want a part for your automobile, you just tell them what car you got and you get a part that'll fit, so on. So all these are necessary and essential. So we're not going to contend with it. You gotta, how far back from the curb your house has got to be built, huh? And you've got a place that you can, gotta have so much parking space for one of those apartments over there, or for this hotel, and everything. Got so many parking spaces, and that's all necessary. So the man-made world is a real nice place to live if you see what it is. If you see what it is, it all works real well. I can't argue with it. I'm glad to live in it. I know I'm not of it. There's no standard of measurements for me. Nobody says, well, Robert, you're too tall, or you're too short, you're too round, or you're too skinny, or whatever. It's like if we had a contest and was going to check all these beautiful ladies out and see if they're right, and I rolled a statue in here and said, now this is pretty. Now let's have all your girls come up and we'll compare you. So you stand in front of it. Some of you don't fill it out all the way. You got a flaw. Some overfill it. You got flaws. Some are too tall, some are too short, some don't have the right colors and et cetera, et cetera. So then everybody has flaws if we had a standard for human beings. Is that right? But the point is, there is no standard, so you're just perfect for you. Absolutely perfect. You're just perfect for you, and you're perfect for you, and this can go on forever. Everybody is a, no two of them alike, so they're each one a unique work of art, as far as I'm concerned, okay? And we don't need to change us humans. And we don't need to change the man-made world. We just know that we are in this world, but we are not of it. Now, next thing we had on there after the standards is games. Now, games have to have certain things to make it a game. First, you got to have players. Without a player, you don't have a game. You've got to have no game, no player, no game. Players, you got to have rules. or it's not a game. If I'm going to set my rules every inch or two, nobody else can stand to play with me. Is that right? I want to move my chess piece over here, and you say, hey, that's not according to the rule. Well, I just changed it. You wouldn't want to play with me very much, okay? And then they must have an official of some sort who kind of sees that the game is played according to the rules. When I have an official. If you play the traffic game, why, they have certain rules out there, and then they got a little guy running up and down the street with little lights on top of his car that broke the rules, John. So I'm going to write you out a little piece of paper. So with the game, we get rule, rewards and punishments, I guess would be the best words, rewards and punishments if we don't play the game according to the rules.